Once again, you're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm your host, William Cooper. Are you one of the people who believe that everything that's happened through history is an accident? And that while one or two things may have been planned, that most of history had no intelligent direction forming it, driving it? Well, listen to this, folks, and listen very carefully. Those desiring substantial evidence of the unfoldment of the great plan should follow the suggestion inscribed upon the monument to Christopher Wren in St. Paul's Cathedral and gaze about them. The rapid advancement in the social and political states of man, the increasing richness of human living, and the broadening vision toward individual and collective responsibility herald with auroral colors the rising of the Sun of Truth. There is much yet to be accomplished, but already the achievement is impressive. Even the most devout humanist cannot survey the orderly progress of the race and at the same time deny the existence of a well-integrated program. The light of the ancient Vedas is slowly but surely illuminating the whole world. The vision of man's noble destiny and the sacred sciences which made possible the realization of that vision have been guarded and served by the silent ones of the earth, the priesthoods of the sacerdotal colleges, the hierophants of the mystery schools, and the adept masters of the secret societies have been the guardians of man's noblest purpose, the perfection of his own kind. It is the inalienable right of every honorable person to be grateful for the opportunities which progress bestows. And with this appreciation comes also an appropriate measure of resolution. The past proves the future, which is but the extension of good works toward their fullness. The mystery schools neither restrained nor limited the unfoldment of human institutions. Man fashioned his civilization according to his natural instincts and convictions. This process must continue, for growth is not hastened by the interference of authority. Man substantiates with his mind and heart that which he fashions with his hands. The esoteric tradition ensouls the ordinary works, revealing the larger purposes through the smaller ones. Not so long ago, 90% of the population of the earth was in physical slavery. Having liberated his body, the audacious creature must now free his heart and mind. Thus, pressed on by sovereign necessity, the world conqueror becomes the self-conqueror. Under a democratic concept of living, the responsibilities for progress pass to the keeping of the people. The powers vested in the governing body, functioning with the consent of the governed, include not only provisions for collective security, but also the advancement of such religions, philosophers, arts, and sciences as contribute to the essential growth of human character. An administrative system which ignores ethics, culture, and morality cannot survive as a dominant political organism. Democratic institutions must accept the task for which they were fashioned and become the conscious custodians of the democratic destiny. Progress demands the most from those with the largest spheres of influence. Vast organizations, industrial, political, social, and educational, have been made possible by the modern life way. These have become the molders of public opinion, feared or respected according to the measure of integrity revealed in their management. The future of human society is intimately associated with the destinies of these vast enterprises, which have inherited, along with physical success, the duty, or more correctly, the privilege of world guardianship. Even the continuance of the economic theory now demands the strengthening of ethical convictions. Prominence of any kind, whether bestowed by wealth or authority, carries with it priestly obligations. The leader, whatever be his field, is looked upon for intelligent guidance. His convictions inspire his followers, his words influence their lives, and his policies dominate their activities. There is every indication that the esoteric tradition will next function through that complex of vast interrelated organisms of production and distribution which now dominates human imagination. While this structure may appear to the superficial minded as heartless and soulless, it is also the largest and most powerful potential instrument for the advancement of mankind ever yet devised. Education, science, and economics are today indivisible. They have already formed a partnership for their mutual advancement. Equipped with knowledge, skill, and the necessary physical resources, this huge combine awaits the destiny for which it was intended. There is no virtue in burdening the future with the conclusions of today. To prophesy is to restrict not the will of heaven, but the mind of man. Old principles, as they reveal more of themselves, will be given new names, and progress is always an adjustment of concepts, each of which is in a constant state of change. Assuming, however, that the term democracy, with its numerous imponderable overtones, conveys a conviction of natural unfoldment, it is reasonable to infer that the democratic motion will continue until all of its potentials have become potencies. Progress is not bound inevitably to any nation or people. Social and political structures are instruments for the advancement of the great work only to the degree that they keep the faith. If ambition or selfishness breaks the bond, the privilege of guardianship is forfeited. And this does not mean that the project fails. Rather, that which fails the project loses the privilege of leadership. The plan, then, passes to the keeping of other groups and other ages. Man cannot destroy or pervert the works of destiny. He can only divide himself from those works and by so doing cease to share in the essential vitality of progress. Thus it is that unreasonable doubts and fears concerning providence are philosophically unsound. Failure is always regrettable, but principles do not fail, and that which is foreordained perfects itself. Although empires may collapse, great teachers be martyred, schools and systems perish, and enlightened leaders remain unhonored, the substance of the great work remains unchanged and unchangeable. New vehicles appear even as the older ones are betrayed by human selfishness. The eternal commonwealth is an assignment of destiny and spiritual progress symbolized by the fabled phoenix, rises victoriously from the ashes of the human ruin. The adept tradition has always available social instruments waiting to be ensouled with the larger vision. All things created by men are mortal and destructible, but the way destined by heaven is immortal and indestructible. Universal enlightenment and universal fraternity are the natural ends which reward the social struggle. The world and all that inhabits it are moving triumphantly toward peace and security. At any given time, the vision may be obscured, but in the larger dimensions of time, all things work together for the fulfillment of the greater good. Is that a piece of excellent retrospective writing looking back on history? No, ladies and gentlemen, it is not. For this was written by Manly P. Hall in Los Angeles, California, in April of 1951. What he predicted is what is happening, a wedding, a marriage between the corporate world and the state, which is coming. He's talking here about socialism. Under a democratic concept of living, the responsibilities for progress pass to the keeping of the people. The powers vested in the governing body functioning with the consent of the governed include not only provisions for collective security, but also the advancement of such religions, philosophies, arts, and science as contribute to the essential growth of human character. Humanism, the concept that man will become God, and the new religion will change with the needs of man, not man conforming to the laws of God. Democratic institutions must accept the task for which they were fashioned and become the conscious custodians of the democratic destiny, and so on and so forth. Manly P. Hall was an adept, a highly degreed. In fact, he was a 33rd degree Freemason, may have held many, many other degrees in the secret societies of Mystery Babylon. He was a priest of the order. Now get comfortable. Make sure that you have everything that you need, folks, because I'm going to take you with me on a journey back to the beginning of all that is, and we are going to come forward from that point to the present so that you will finally have an understanding of America's assignment with destiny. Thank you. Three great cultural heroes were associated with the origin of Mayan civilization. Votan, who founded the Votanic Empire, seated at Palenque, Itzamna, the Yucatecan hero, and Kukulkan, whose worship extended throughout the Central American area. All three came from a remote region lying eastward, introducing arts and sciences, and founded religious cults, or mysteries. From the legendary histories of these persons, they should be included as adepts or initiates of ancient secret schools, possibly Atlantean. In a book written in the Kichian language and attributed to Votan, the Great One declared him self, a snake, a descendant of Imos in the line of Khan. He came to America by the command of God from a distant place. He ultimately founded Palenque and built a temple with many subterranean chambers, which was called the House of Darkness. Here he deposited the records of his nation in the keeping of certain aged men called guardians. There is a legend, folks, that this Votan was the grandson of Noah. The original book containing this report was in the possession of Nunez de la Vega, Bishop of Chiapas, but he destroyed it with the other native manuscripts which he was able to accumulate. Fortunately, however, it had been copied by Aguilar. Itzamna, according to Cagulodo, was a priest who came with the migrations from the east. He was the son of the supreme deity Hunabku, or the Holy One. Itzamna is pictured as an ancient man with a very prominent and strangely shaped nose, either toothless or with one crooked fang. Likenesses of him have been found indicating his birth from a plant growing from the earth. He is also shown rising from the mouth of a serpent or a turtle to symbolize that he came from the sea. He healed the sick and restored the dead to life. He lived, according to the records, to a great age and was said to have been buried at Izamal, or Itzamal, where his tombs became places of pilgrimages. Itzamna was sometimes called the Skillful Hand, and after his death, his body was divided. His skillful hand was placed in one temple, his heart in another, and the rest of his remains in a third. One of the best known of his emblems was a Tau, or T-cross. It is now generally admitted that the Quetzalcoatl of the Nahuatlan people, the Gucumats of the Quiches, and the Kukulkan of the more southern Mayas were one person. In each language, the word signifies feathered, plumed, or winged serpent. This title may have resulted from Quetzalcoatl casting his lot among, or gathering his first followers from, the descendants of Votan. This tribal group had the serpent as its heraldic device. At a remote time, this semi-mystical, semi-divine priest-initiate, Quetzalcoatl, came from the fabled land of the seven colors and established his rite at Tula and Cholula. Quetzalcoatl was the initiate philosopher and teacher of the Nahuatlan tribes of central Mexico. Among the appellations of this priest-prophet-king are, quote, he who was born of the Virgin, unquote, quote, Lord of the Winds, unquote, and, quote, the Divine Incarnation, unquote. Quetzalcoatl was the son of the universal creator god and the Virgin, Xochiquetzal, and his conception was made known by an ambassador from the god of the Milky Way. Torquemada, in his Indian Monarchies, described a band of people who came from the north dressed in long black robes. Arriving at Tula, these strangers were well received, but finding the region already thickly populated, they continued to Cholula. These wanderers were great artists and skilled in working metals. Quetzalcoatl was their leader. Mendieta, in his Ecclesiastical History, described Quetzalcoatl as a white man with a strong formation of body, broad forehead, large eyes, and a flowing beard. He wore a mitre on his head and was dressed in a long white robe reaching to his feet and covered with a design of red crosses. In his hand, he held a sickle. His habits were ascetic. He never married and was most chaste and pure in his life, and it is said to have endured penance in a neighboring mountain, not for its effect upon himself, mind you, but as an example to others. He condemned sacrifices except of fruit or flowers and was known as the God of Peace, for when he addressed on the subject of war, he is reported to have stopped his ears with his fingers. Fray Bernardino de Sahagún described Quetzalcoatl as very homely, with a long head and a very long beard. There was a recumbent statue of him in the temple at Tula, which was always covered with blankets. His vassals, writes the good Fray, were all workmen in the mechanic arts and skillful in cutting the green stones called chalchivits, also in the art of smelting silver and making other objects. All these arts had their origin and commencement with Quetzalcoatl, who had houses made with these precious green stones called chalchivits, and others made of silver, still others made of red and white shells, others all made of boards, and again others of turquoises, and some all made of rich plumes. Quetzalcoatl also owned all the wealth of the world in gold, silver, and the green stones called chalcivites, and other precious things, and had a great abundance of cocoa trees of different colors, which are called Xochicacatlau. The said vassals of Quetzalcoatl were also very wealthy and did not lack anything at all. They never suffered famine or lack of corn. In fact, they never ate even the small ears of corn, but rather heated their baths with them, using them instead of firewood. They also say that the said Quetzalcoatl did penance by pricking his limbs and drawing blood, with which he stained the maguey points, that he bathed at midnight in a spring called Zicapea. The interpreter of the Codex Telleriano-Remensis said that Quetzalcoatl was created by the breath of Tonacaticotli. Quetzalcoatl was born on the day of seven canes and disappeared or died on the day of one cane. He was identified with the planet Venus. The Codex Vaticanus A says that the hero founded four temples, the first for the princes, the second for the people, the third, the house of fear, are serpents, and the fourth, the temple of shame. The Codex Chimalpopca says that Quetzalcoatl was born as a nine-year-old child. When he resolved to leave Mexico, he reached the seashore and, removing his clothing and his snake mask of turquoise, destroyed himself by fire. His ashes changed into birds, and his heart became the morning star. He remained 4 days in the underworld and 4 days as a corpse. After that, he ascended to heaven as a god. It is specifically mentioned by Sahagún that Quetzalcoatl created and built houses under the earth. Now, traces of subterranean grottos and rooms have been discovered in the vicinity of most of the architectural monuments of the Nahuas. There is a vast complex of such apartments near the Pyramid of the Sun at San Juan Teotihuacan. The Amerindians believed the serpent to be an earth dweller, and it is quite possible that the accounts implied these subterranean and secret places to be chambers of initiation into the mysteries of the cult. According to de Borberg, the Mexican demigod Votan made a journey through a subterranean passage which, running underground, terminated at the root of heaven. This passage was a snake hole, and Votan was admitted because he was himself a son of the snake. Quetzalcoatl appeared as the great sorcerer, magician, or necromancer. He performed miracles, and upon his departure, his secrets were entrusted to an order of priests governed by a hierophant or master. This priesthood practiced the arts and sciences, treated the sick, administered sacraments, and were diviners and prophets. Landa gives some consideration to the activities of these religious orders. Lucien Biart summarizes the available data thusly. The most contradictory ideas have been current in regard to this divinity, who now considered of celestial origin and now regarded as a man who had acquired the immortality of the gods, seems in reality to be a union of several personages. He certainly belonged to a race other than the one he civilized, of that there can be no doubt. But what was his country? He died announcing that he would return at the head of white-faced men, and we have seen that the Indians believed his prophecy fulfilled when the Spaniards landed on their shores. And of course, we have seen the consequences of that action. According to Sahagun, the most usual ornaments of the images of Quetzalcoatl were a mitre spotted like the skin of a tiger, a short embroidered tunic, turquoise earrings, and a golden collar supporting fine shells. The legs of these images were encased in gaiters of tiger skins, and on their feet were black sandals. A shield hung from the left arm, and in the right hand was a scepter ornamented with precious stones, an emblem which terminated in a crook like a bishop's crozier. Quetzalcoatl is credited with the invention of the pictorial or hieroglyphical method of writing, and especially is his name associated with the Tonalamatl, our Book of Fate. This was more than a civil calendar and was reserved for the calculation of human destiny and prophecies concerning the future of the state. It was used by master magicians, the chief of whom was an astrological adept credited with extraordinary occult powers. While it is likely that Quetzalcoatl brought the Tonalamatl back to Mexico after his journey among the Mayas, a people already advanced in such matters, the Aztecan legend has been summarized by Mendieta. The gods had created a man, Oxomoco, and a woman, Cipactonatl, as the progenitors of the human race. They, according to the legend, dwelt in a cave at Cuernavaca, and in order to regulate their lives, these two resolved to devise a calendar. Cipactonatl felt that her descendant, Quetzalcoatl, should be invited to participate in the project, because she was the mother of all the living and a great prophetess. Cipactonatl was privileged to select and write the first sign or day symbol of the calendar. The others followed until the 13 signs were completed. Sahagun, in his general history, gave a number of details of the struggle between Quetzalcoatl, the civilizer, and Tezcatlipoca, who apparently signified the primitive and sanguine religious cult of Mexico. The old priesthood, which practiced human sacrifice and adhered to a policy of war and destruction, resented the peaceful and gentle faith brought by Quetzalcoatl. In the end, Tezcatlipoca, the personification of the sorcerers, contrived to poison the god-king, which implies that his doctrines were corrupted by false teachings and interpretations. The poison worked slowly and insidiously until Quetzalcoatl, realizing that he could not combat successfully the old perverted priesthood, left Cholula, ordering his palaces of gold and silver, turquoise and precious stones to be set afire. Accompanied by a procession of musicians, youths, and maidens bearing flowers, and flocks of singing birds, the old adept journeyed to Cholula, where the Great Pyramid was built in his honor. It was written that the Cholulans deeply admired the great priest because of the purity of his life, the kindliness of his manner, and his doctrines of peace and brotherhood. He remained with them for nearly 20 years, slowly sickening from the poison which was destroying his body. At last, he realized that his ministry was coming to an end, so he continued his long journey toward the mysterious city of Tlapalan, from which he had come. He turned toward the east and proceeded to the sea, which he reached at a point a few miles south of Veracruz. Here he blessed the four young men who had accompanied him and bade them return to their homes, with his promise that one day in the future he would return and restore his kingdom among them. It's time for our break, folks. Don't go away. I'll be right back after this very short pause. Folks, this is William Cooper for Swiss America Trading. Now, for those of you who have been listening to this program for any length of time, you already know that I've been passing along information that indicates that we're in serious economic trouble. In fact, we're fast approaching the end, not the end of the world, the end of money as we know it. And when this situation hits, the money as we know it will cease simply to exist. Now, folks, listen very carefully. I want you to be one of these people. For the next 200 of you who call Swiss America Trading, you can receive a free copy of Harry Figge's report entitled Tackle the Debt. In it, you will see for yourself just how bad our debt situation is, according to Mr. Figge. And I agree with him. But knowing we are in trouble just isn't good enough. You also need to know how to protect yourself, and that's why I recommend Swiss America Trading for non-confiscatable, non-reportable hard assets and other investments which they have available. Call our friends at Swiss America Trading right now at 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. They will not only inform you with this free Figge report to the first 200 callers, but will also show you how to protect your future. Call them. Don't procrastinate. Do it now. 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. And while you're at it, mention my name, William Cooper, and you will also receive a free newsletter on protecting your future. When the dust settles, folks, and everything is open to the light of day, where will you stand? Will you be left holding the bag, worthless money, or will you have protected yourself through an investment, a wise investment, with Swiss America Trading? Of course, the choice is yours. It always is. Call today, right now, 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. By protecting your future, you're helping to protect the future of the hour, of the time, and freedom for the world. Call now. You'll be glad that you did. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce to you a young man who has come to be my right hand, my assistant, who has come to learn as much as he can, and of course, I am going to learn as much as I can from him. His official title around here is Research Assistant. Mr. Tom Swift will continue with the rest of tonight's program.
Where we left off, Quetzalcoatl had just promised the four young men that one day in the future, he would return and restore his kingdom among them. Then the old and weary man called to the sea, and out of the waters came a raft of serpents. He stepped upon this strange craft and was carried away into the land of the sun's beginning. He left behind him a priesthood that perpetuated with esoteric rites the mysteries of the feathered serpent. There is every indication that the cult of Quetzalcoatl was kept secret, a precaution necessary in the face of the opposition of the primitive indigenous sects. There are several accounts of the death or departure of Quetzalcoatl. The conflict is due in part to the legends being derived from different tribes, and in part to the Spanish methods of gathering the reports. These invaders took slight interest in the native traditions until they had destroyed most of the available sources of information. Later, even the converted Indians were uncertain of their tribal history. There is reason to believe, however, that some sacred records were intentionally suppressed and were never available to the missionaries. The people of Mexico claim to have sacred accounts of the mysteries of their religion and of the origin of their race. There is mention of the divine book written by Tezcucan, a wise man or wizard whose name means Lord of the Great Hand. This was supposed to contain the account of the migration of the Aztecs from Asia. Baron de Waldeck claimed that the book had once been in his possession. De Burberg thought that it was the Dresden Codex, and Bustamante wrote that native historians had a copy in their possession at the time of the fall of Mexico. There is good probability that manuscripts of great value survived the Spanish colonial period and are still available to certain qualified persons. Augustus Le Plongeon, known to the Yucatecans as Great Blackbeard, was one of the few Americanists to be accepted into the confidence of the ever-reticent Indians. They told him enough to convince a thoughtful man of the existence of the esoteric schools in the Mayan area. That sacred mysteries, writes Le Plongeon, have existed in America from times immemorial, there can be no doubt. Even setting aside the proofs of their existence that we gather from the monuments of Uxmal and the descriptions of the trials of initiations related in the sacred book of Quiches, we find vestiges of them in various other countries of the Western continent. The rites and ceremonies of initiation were imported to Peru by the ancestor of Manco Capac, the founder of the Inca dynasty, who were colonists from Central America, as we learn from an unpublished manuscript written by a Jesuit father, the Reverend Anello Oliva. at the beginning of the year 1631 in Lima, and now in the library of the British Museum in London. A number of authors who have tried to prove that Quetzalcoatl was a foreigner who, reaching the shores of the New World at an early time, attempted the civilization of the aboriginal tribes. Lord Kingsborough favored the possibility that this wanderer was the Apostle Thomas, and that the ancient Central American Indians came under Christian or Jewish influence. Always deeply concerned with the possibilities of linking the worship in the Americas with the religions of the Near East, his lordship writes, "The Messiah is shadowed in the Old Testament under many types, such as those of a lion, a lamb, a rose, the morning star, or the planet Venus, otherwise called Lucifer, the sun, light, a rock, a stone, the branch, the vine, wine, bread, water, life, the way, and he is recognized in the triple character of a king, a priest, and a prophet." It is very extraordinary that Quetzalcoatl, whom the Mexicans believe to equally to have been a king, a prophet, and a pontiff, should also have been named by them Seyacatl, or the morning star, Tevazcalpantecutli, or light, Mexitli, or the vine, for Torquemada said that the core of the aloe from which the Mexicans obtained wine was so called, Votan, or the heart, metaphorically signifying life, and Toyalacuatl, manjar de nuestra vida, bread, for his body made of dough was eaten by the Mexicans. Las Casas, quoting Padre Francisco Hernandez, says that an old Yucatecan, described the ancient religion of his people thus, that they recognized and believed in God who dwells in heaven, and that this God was Father and Son and Holy Spirit, and that the Father was called Icona, who had created men and all things, that the Son was called Bacab, that he was born of a virgin called Chiberis, who is in heaven with God. The Holy Spirit they termed Ecuac. The son Bacab was scourged and crowned with thorns, was tied upon a cross with extended arms, where he died. But after 3 days he arose and ascended into heaven to be with his father. Dr. Alexander, who reports this story in his book, is inclined that it is confused and probably distorted by the Spanish recorder. On the other hand, the universal distribution of this basic theme may be explained another way. Among the Lacandones, Quetzalcoatl is still represented as a snake with many heads. There is an account that this snake was killed and eaten at times of great national peril, especially at eclipses, which were regarded as portents of disaster. It was believed by the Mayas that Kukulcan descended invisibly from the sky and personally received the offerings during certain great feasts held in his honor. Daniel Brinton, in his Essays of an Americanist, devoted some thought to the magical powers attributed to the priests of Central America. He mentioned Father Biza and an English priest, Thomas Gage, who reported cases of sorcerers transforming themselves into animals and performing miracles. De Boerberg was not entirely convinced that ventriloquism, animal magnetism, or the tricks familiarly employed by conjurers explain the mysteries of Nahualism, as the black art of these Indians is called. Brenton quotes from the Popol Vuh, "Truly, this Gumez Quetzalcoatl became a wonderful king. Every 7 days he ascended to the sky, and every 7 days he followed the path to the abode of the dead. Every 7 days he put on the nature of a serpent, and he became truly a serpent. Every 7 days he put on the nature of an eagle, and again of a tiger, and he became truly an eagle and a tiger." It is evident from available authorities that the Mayas and Aztecs had an extensive body of legendary and lore, which originated in the mysteries of their religion and proves the existence of an elaborate system of secret rites and ceremonies. In the form of a feathered snake, Quetzalcoatl overshadowed a dynasty of rulers and priests, some of whom later assumed his name and even his mask symbol. These later Quetzalcoatls have been confused, like the Zoroasters of Persia, into one person, with the resulting conflict in dates. Recent excavations would indicate that the cult of the feathered serpent was established before the beginning of the Christian era and did not arise in the 10th or 11th century AD as held by some modern archaeologists. It is more likely that the ancient hero was said to have been reborn or to have overshadowed a later leader of the nation. All of the accounts imply that the religious order which served the mysteries of Quetzalcoatl was long established. Those who followed in the way which he had prescribed lived most severe lives. Children were consecrated to his temples from their birth, and were marked by a special collar. At the end of the second year, the child was scarified in the breast. When it was 7 years old, it entered a seminary where it took vows covering personal conduct and public duties, including prayers for the preservation of its family and its nation. There were many of these priestly brotherhoods, and the Spanish missionaries, in spite of their theological prejudices and intolerances, were forced to admit that the Aztecan priests were excellent scholars and lived austere and pure lives. It is said of these missionaries that in Quetzalcoatl, who taught charity, gentleness, and peace, they thought they saw a disciple of Jesus Christ. The kings of the Mexican nations, like those of ancient Egypt, were also initiates of the state mysteries. Torquemada described the attainments of Nazahualpilli, the king of Texuco. This learned man gathered about him masters of the sciences and arts, and gained a wide reputation as an astrologer and seer. When Montezuma was elected to rule over the complex of Nahuatl nations, King Nazahualpilli stood before the young man and congratulated the entire nation for having selected such a ruler, whose deep knowledge of heavenly things ensured to his subjects his comprehension of those of an earthly nature. The interpreter of the collection of Mendoza described Montezuma as, by nature, wise, an astrologer and philosopher, and skilled and generally versed in all of the arts, both in those of the military as well as those of a civil nature. And from his extreme gravity and state, the monarchy under his sway began to verge towards empire. The great serpent, clothed in Quetzal plumes, certainly belonged to another race and came from an unknown country. Lucien Biot says, "It is an incontestable fact that Quetzalcoatl created a new religion based upon fasting, penitence, and virtue. In skillful trades and in metalworking, this Amerindian savior reminds one of the craftsmen of Tyre who cast the ornaments for Solomon's temple. As a benefactor of his people, as a liberator of men's minds and hearts, this Nahuatl demigod certainly revealed the attributes of the master builder." Scattered through the jungles of Yucatan and extending northward into Chiapas and southward into Honduras and Guatemala are the remains of ancient cities and the ruins of old cultural centers, religious or educational, dedicated to scientific research and the investigation of the spiritual mysteries of human life. These shrines and temples are adorned with numerous religious emblems and figures, and closely resemble the temples and schools of the esoteric tradition, which were scattered through the Mediterranean countries, North Africa, and the Near East. The Aztecs inhabiting the Valley of Mexico certainly derived much of their cultural impetus from the more highly civilized Mayas. These Nahuas practiced elaborate rites and ceremonies, and recognized a large pantheon of divinities. It seems unlikely that the Aztecs patterned their religious concepts from some inferior cultural tradition. These are positive indications that the tribes of central Mexico had received an important intellectual stimulus from the Mayas, and even found it expedient to acknowledge this indebtedness. The physical remains of the Mayan civilization are sufficiently impressive to indicate a highly advanced people, whose religious institutions and rites had reached a considerable degree of refinement. Most early writers, in an attempt to estimate the cultural attainments of these nations, have been over-influenced by the early theologians and scientific enthusiasts who invaded the field with a variety of concept and preconceptions. The empires of the Mayas and Aztecs were resplendent with edifices dedicated to their faith. They were magnificent shrines, temples, altars, some to sanguinary deities and others to benign and kindly gods. The state mysteries, however, were seldom performed in the sanctuaries of popular worship. Neophytes traveled to remote places, and if they went uninvited, seldom returned. Throughout the jungles are the ruins of extraordinary buildings constructed for unknown purposes. The mysteries of Xibalba, as recorded in the Popol Vuh, and traditionally associated with the culture hero Votan, were given in such an architectural complex which served as an entrance to a mysterious world beyond the dimensions of the material mind. Such gateways existed in all the old countries where the mystery religion originally flourished. Obviously, archaeologists cannot discover the secret rites merely by grubbing among the overturned and broken stones. As the priesthoods were not considered enough to label their monuments, there is little left today even to excite curiosity. Fortunately, however, the esoteric tradition survives in the racial subconscious, and its violated schools and colleges need not be physically restored. When such restoration is attempted, The buildings usually reveal that they were designed as symbols of the cosmos. If the mystery system actually existed in the Western Hemisphere, as the landmarks seem to indicate, it must have been produced its initiates and by its adepts. These in turn became the leaders and saviors of the peoples, their wonder-working hero, whose deeds enriched all tribal traditions, always and everywhere performed the exact same miracles, possessed the exact same powers, and made the exact same personal sacrifices. The mystery school required not only a hierarchy for its maintenance and perpetuation, but also appropriate places of initiation, partly underground or adjacent to grottos and caverns. It required also a body of lore particularly significant, participation in which conferred special rights and privileges. A people which had reached this mental platform of the Mayas would not have accepted a philosophy of life that was without profound and significant values. Pagan priesthood did not initiate those of feeble mind, but selected for spiritual advancement persons of high attainment and mature judgment. Albert Reville, in the Hibbard Lectures, 1894, notes of the religion of the plumed serpent, "There was something mysterious and occult about the priesthood of this deity, as though it were possessed of divine secrets or promises, the importance of which it would be dangerous to undervalue." It is fortunate indeed that at least one manuscript relating to the religious mysteries formerly practiced in the Mayan area had been recovered. The Popol Vuh, or the Senate Book of the Quiches, the record of the community, has survived the numerous vicissitudes which have conspired to prevent the perpetuation of the literary monuments of Central America. It was tolerated by the early missionaries who, observing certain similarities to their own scriptures, preserved the work as a means of persuading the Indians to a more speedy baptism. In the 17th century, it was rescued from a fate worse than oblivion by the Dominican monk Don Ramon de Ordonez y Aguilar, dean and chancellor of the Archbishopric of Ciudad Real. This work was deposited in the library of the convent at Chichicastenango by the scholiast Ximenes, where it remained until the year 1830.
Thank you, Tom. Ladies and gentlemen, that was his first time ever speaking over radio around the world. Of course, he's called into talk shows before, but this is different when you're sitting at the microphone and it's your thing. When you know that one slip could cause a flood of letters in protest, Tom sat here and performed admirably while we were experiencing a terrible windstorm. You may have heard some strange noises in the background. Those were pieces of trees and wood and lawn furniture and just about everything that you could think of flying through the air, hitting the house. So he had an awful lot of competition vying for his attention. And it took a great effort, along with his natural nervousness at doing this for the first time, took a great effort to maintain, keep his attention on what he was doing, and complete that half of the hour of the time. Now, if you'd like to write Tom and tell him who you are and say hello, how much you appreciate his help on this program, The Hour of the Time, you can do so by writing to Tom Swift, Research Assistant, care of CAJI, C-A-J-I, P.O. Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. That's Tom Swift, Research Assistant, CAJI, C-A-J-I, Post Office Box 1420, Sholo, Arizona, 85901. Tonight's broadcast, ladies and gentlemen, came from a book entitled America's Assignment with Destiny by Manly P. Hall. Some of you may be able to find this in your library or in a used bookstore. It has been out of print for many years. It was copyrighted in 1951. Printed by the Philosophical Research Society, which was headed by Manly P. Hall at that time. Now, you may not realize this, but Manly P. Hall has died in the last several years, and bit by bit, the unbelievably huge library that he had accumulated over his years that made up the bulk of the Philosophical Research Society has disappeared. Good night, and God bless you all. You're listening to the only hour that ever was or ever will be. You're listening to the hour of the time, during which you will decide your future and thus our collective futures. I'm your host, William Cooper. Tonight's program, ladies and gentlemen, comes from a book by Manly P. Hall named America's Assignment with Destiny. And last night, we had our young research assistant do the last half of the program, and we understand that some of his narrative could not be understood, as it was his first try at radio broadcasting, and we're going to continue to work with him, and he's going to get better, and he's going to do some more programs on the hour of the time, because we like to share everything around here and give everybody a chance to be the best that they can be. So I'm going to continue tonight where I left off at the halfway point in the program to make sure that nobody misses any portion of any of this series. And we continue now. It was written that the Cholulans deeply admired Quetzalcoatl, the great priest, because of the purity of his life, the kindliness of his manner, and his doctrines of peace and brotherhood. He remained with them for nearly 20 years, slowly sickening from the poison which was destroying his body. At last he realized that his ministry was coming to an end, so he continued his long journey toward the mysterious city of Tlapalan, from which he had come. He turned toward the east and proceeded to the sea, which he reached at a point a few miles just south of Veracruz. Here he blessed the four young men who had accompanied him and bade them return to their homes with his promise that one day in the future he would return and restore his kingdom among them. Then the old and weary man called to the sea, and out of the waters came a raft of serpents. He stepped upon this strange craft and was carried away into the land of the sun's beginning. He left behind him a priesthood that perpetuated with esoteric rites the mysteries of the feathered serpent. There is every indication, folks, that the cult of Quetzalcoatl was kept secret, a precaution necessary in the face of the opposition of the primitive indigenous sects. There are several accounts of the death or departure of Quetzalcoatl. The conflict is due in part to the legends being derived from different tribes and in part to the Spanish methods of gathering the reports. Now, these invaders took slight interest in the native traditions until they had destroyed most of the available sources of information. Later, even the converted Indians were uncertain of their tribal history. There's reason to believe, however, that some sacred records were intentionally suppressed and were never available to the missionaries. The people of Mexico claim to have sacred accounts of the mysteries of their religion and the origin of their race. There's mention of the divine book written by Tezcucan, a wise man or wizard whose name means Lord of the Great Hand. This was supposed to contain the account of the migration of the Aztecs from Asia. Baron de Waldeck claimed that the book had once been in his possession. De Bourbourg thought it was the Dresden Codex. The Bustamante wrote that native historians had a copy in their possession at the time of the fall of Mexico. Now, there's good probability that manuscripts of great value survived the Spanish colonial period and are still available to certain qualified persons. Augustus Leplongeon, known to the Yucatecans as Great Blackbeard, was one of the few Americanists to be accepted into the confidence of the ever-reticent Indians. They told him enough to convince a thoughtful man of the existence of esoteric schools in the Mayan area. Quote, that sacred mysteries, unquote, writes Leplongeon, have existed in America from times immemorial, there can be no doubt. Even setting aside the proofs of their existence that we gather from the monuments of Uxmal and the descriptions of the trials of initiation related in the sacred book of the Quiches, we find vestiges of them in various other countries of the Western continent. The rites and ceremonies of initiation were imported in Peru by the ancestors of Manco Capac, the founder of the Inca dynasty, who were colonists from Central America, as we learn from an unpublished manuscript written by a Jesuit father, Reverend Anello Oliva, at the beginning of the year 1631 in Lima, and now It resides in the library of the British Museum in London. A number of authors have tried to prove that Quetzalcoatl was a foreigner who, reaching the shores of the New World at an early time, attempted the civilization of the aboriginal tribes. Lord Kingsborough favored the possibility that this wanderer was actually the Apostle Thomas, and that the ancient Central American Indians came under Christian or Jewish influence. Always deeply concerned with the possibilities of linking the worship in the Americas with the religions of the Near East, his lordship writes, "The Messiah is shadowed in the Old Testament under many types, such as those of a lion, a lamb, a rose, the morning star, or the planet Venus, otherwise called Lucifer, the sun, light, a rock, a stone, the branch, the vine, wine, bread, water, life, the way." And he is there recognized in the triple character of a king, a priest, and a prophet. It is very extraordinary that Quetzalcoatl, whom the Mexicans believed equally to have been a king, a prophet, and a pontiff, should also have been named by them Seacatl, or Keacatl, or the morning star. Lavizcalpantecutli, or light. Mexitli, or the vine. For Torquemada said that the core of the aloe from which the Mexicans obtained wine was so called. Votan, or the heart, metaphorically signifying light, and Toilietlquitl, manjar de Nestra Veda, bread for his body made of dough, was eaten by the Mexicans. Las Casas, quoting Padre Francisco Hernandez, says that an old Yucatecan described the ancient religion of his people thus, that they recognized and believed in God who dwells in heaven, and that this God was Father and Son and Holy Spirit, and that the Father was called Icona, who had created men and all things, that the Son was called Bacav, and that he was born of a virgin called Chibirius, who is in heaven with God. The Holy Spirit they tamed Ichuik. The son Bacab was scourged and crowned with thorns, was tied upon a cross with extended arms where he died, but after 3 days he arose and ascended into heaven to be with his Father. Dr. Alexander, who reports this story in his book, is inclined to feel that it is confused and probably distorted by the Spanish recorder. On the other hand, the universal distribution of the basic theme may be explained another way. Among the Lacandones, Quetzalcoatl is still represented as a snake with many heads. There is an account that this snake was killed and eaten at times of great national peril, especially at eclipses, which were regarded as portents of disaster. It was believed by the Mayas that Kukulkan descended invisibly from the sky and personally received the offerings during great feast held in his honor. For details of this, consult The Mythology of All Ages, Volume 11, Latin American, by Hartley Burr Alexander. Now, Daniel Brenton, in his Essays of an Americanist, devoted some thought to the magical powers attributed to the priests of Central America. He mentioned Father Bieza and an English priest, Thomas Gage, who reported cases of sorcerers transforming themselves into animals and performing other miracles. De Bourbourg was not entirely convinced that ventriloquism, animal magnetism, or the tricks familiarly employed by conjurers explained the mysteries of Nahualism, as the black art of these Indians is called. Brenton quotes from the Popol Vuh, "Truly, thus, Gucumatz, Quetzalcoatl, became a wonderful king. Every 7 days he ascended to the sky, and every 7 days he followed the path to the abode of the dead. Every 7 days he put on the nature of a serpent, and he became truly a serpent. Every 7 days he put on the nature of an eagle, and again of a tiger, and he became truly an eagle and a tiger." It is evident from available authorities that the Mayas and Aztecs had an extensive body of legendary and lore, which originated in the mysteries of their religions and proves the existence of an elaborate system of secret rites and ceremonies. In the form of a feathered snake, Quetzalcoatl overshadowed a dynasty of rulers and priests, some of whom later assumed his name and even his mask symbol. These later Quetzalcoatls have been confused, like the several Zoroasters of Persia, into one person, with a resulting conflict in dates. Recent excavations would indicate that the cult of the feathered serpent was established before the beginning of the Christian era and did not arise in the 10th or 11th century AD as held by some modern archaeologists. In fact, it is more likely that the ancient hero was said to have been reborn or to have overshadowed a later leader of the nation. All the accounts imply that the religious order which served the mysteries of Quetzalcoatl was long established, and those who follow in the way which he had prescribed lived most severe lives. Children were consecrated to his temples from their birth and were marked by a special collar. At the end of the second year, the child was scarified in the breast. When it was 7 years old, it entered a seminary where it took vows covering personal conduct and public duties, including prayers for the preservation of its family and its nation. There were many of these priestly brotherhoods, and the Spanish missionaries, in spite of their theological prejudices and intolerances, were forced to admit that the Aztecan priests were excellent scholars and lived austere and pure lives. It was said of these missionaries that in Quetzalcoatl, who taught charity, gentleness, and peace, they thought they saw a disciple of Jesus Christ. The kings of the Mexican nations, like those of ancient Egypt, were also initiates of the state mysteries. Torquemada described the attainments of Nezahualpilli, the king of Texcoco. This learned man gathered about him masters of the science and arts and gained a wide reputation as an astrologer and seer. When Montezuma was elected to rule over the complex of Nahuatlan nations, King Nezahualpilli stood before the young man and congratulated the entire nation for having selected such a ruler, whose deep knowledge of heavenly things ensured to his subjects his comprehension of those of an earthly nature. The interpreter of the collection of Mendoza described Montezuma as by nature wise, an astrologer and philosopher, and skilled and generally versed in all the arts, both in those of the military as well as those of a civil nature, and from his extreme gravity and state, the monarchy under his sway began to verge towards empire. The great serpent clothed in Quetzal plumes certainly belonged to another race and came from an unknown country. Lucien Biart says, "It is an incontestable fact that Quetzalcoatl created a new religion based upon fasting, penitence, and virtue. In skillful trades and in metalworking, this Amerindian savior reminds one of the craftsmen of Tyre who cast the ornaments for Solomon's temple. As a benefactor of his people, as a liberator of men's minds and hearts, this Nahuatlan demigod certainly revealed the attributes of the master builder." Folks, are you beginning to hear the implications that this may be connected to the ancient mysteries and directly to Freemasonry? For that is exactly what Manly Hall is putting across. Scattered through the jungle of Yucatan and extending northward into Chiapas and southward into Honduras and Guatemala are the remains of ancient cities and the ruins of old cultural centers, religious or educational, dedicated to scientific research and the investigation of the spiritual mysteries of human life. These shrines and temples are adorned with numerous religious emblems and figures and closely resemble the temples and schools of the esoteric tradition, which were scattered through the Mediterranean countries, North Africa, and the Near East. The Aztecs, inhabiting the Valley of Mexico, certainly derived much of their cultural impetus from the more highly civilized Mayas. These Nahuas practiced elaborate rites and ceremonies and recognized a large pantheon of divinities. It seemed unlikely that the Aztecs patterned their religious concepts from some inferior cultural tradition. There are positive indications that the tribes of central Mexico had received an important intellectual stimulus from the Mayas and even found it expedient to acknowledge this indebtedness. The physical remains of the Maya civilization are sufficiently impressive to indicate a highly advanced people whose religious institutions and rites had reached a considerable degree of refinement. Most early writers, in an attempt to estimate the cultural attainments of these nations, have been over-influenced by the early theologians and scientific enthusiasts who invaded the field with a variety of concepts and, of course, preconceptions. The empires of the Mayas and Aztecs were resplendent with edifices dedicated to their faiths. There were magnificent shrines, temples, and altars, some to sanguinary deities and others to benign and kindly gods. The state mysteries, however, were seldom performed in the sanctuaries of popular worship. Neophytes traveled to remote places, and if they went uninvited, they seldom, if ever, returned. Throughout the jungle are the ruins of extraordinary buildings constructed for unknown purposes. The mysteries of Xibalba, as recorded in the Popol Vuh, and traditionally associated with the culture hero Votan, were given in such an architectural complex which served as an entrance to a mysterious world beyond the dimensions of the material mind. Such gateways existed in all the old countries where the mystery religion originally flourished. Obviously, archaeologists cannot discover the secret rites merely by grubbing among the overturned and broken stones. As the priesthoods were not considerate enough to label their monuments, there is little left today even to excite curiosity. Fortunately, however, the esoteric tradition survives in the racial subconscious, whatever that is, and its violated schools and colleges need not be physically restored. When such restoration is attempted, the buildings usually reveal that they were designed as symbols of the cosmos. If the mystery system existed in the Western Hemisphere, as the landmarks indicate, it must have produced its initiates and adepts. These, in turn, became the leaders and saviors of their peoples. The wonder-working hero, whose deeds enriched all tribal traditions, always and everywhere, performed the same miracles, possessed the same powers, and made the same personal sacrifices. The mystery school required not only a hierarchy for its maintenance and perpetuation, but also appropriate places of initiation, partly underground or adjacent to grottos and caverns. It required also a body of lore peculiarly significant, participation in which conferred special rights and privileges. A people which had reached the mental platform of the Mayas would not have accepted a philosophy of life that was without profound and significant values. Pagan priesthoods did not initiate those of feeble mind, but selected for spiritual advancement persons of high attainment and mature judgment. Albert Reveille, in the Hibbard Lectures, 1894, notes of the religion of the plumed serpent. There was something mysterious and occult about the priesthood of this deity, as though it were possessed of divine secrets or promises, the importance of which it would be dangerous to undervalue. It is fortunate, indeed, that at least one manuscript relating to the religious mysteries formerly practiced in the Mayan area has been recovered. The Popol Vuh, or the Senate Book of the Quiches, the record of the community, has survived the numerous vicissitudes which have conspired to prevent the perpetuation of the literary monuments of Central America. It was tolerated by the early missionaries, who, observing certain similarities to their own scriptures, preserved the work as a means of persuading the Indians to a more speedy baptism. In the 17th century, it was rescued from a fate worse than oblivion by the Dominican monk Don Ramon de Ordonez y Aguirre, Dean and Chancellor of the Archbishopric of Ciudad Real. The work was deposited in the library of the convent at Chichicastenango by its scholiast, Zeminis, where it remained until 1830. The manuscript of the Popol Vuh was rediscovered about 1855 by Dr. Chazar in the library of the University of San Carlos, Guatemala City. through the industry and scholarship of that ardent antiquarian, the Abbe Brasseur de Bourbourg, this mysterious book of the Quiches came at last to the French language, where it lingered for years, awaiting English translation. Dr. Scherzer was responsible for a Spanish version published in Vienna in 1856. The first English translation has remained practically unknown to students of Central American archaeology, as it appeared serially in The Word, a magazine devoted to theosophical and related subjects. The translation was made by Kenneth S. Guthrie, M.A., Ph.D., M.D., and was based upon the French text. A new English translation from the Spanish of Adrian Recinos has just been issued by the University of Oklahoma Press, and folks, that was in 1951. This version is by Delia Goetz and Sylvanus G. Morley and includes important introductory and commentary material. Writing under the pseudonym Aretas James Price issued part of the Popol Vuh with learned commentaries under the title The Book of the Azure Veil. This ran in Lucifer, a theosophical magazine, between September 1894 and February 1895. It concluded with a note that circumstances made it impossible for the translator to finish the work. Price suggests that the god Quetzalcoatl was known in Peru under the name of Amaru. He writes, "From the latter name comes our word America. Amaruca is literally translated land of the plumed serpent. The priests of this god of peace, from their chief center in the Cordilleras, once ruled both Americas. All the red men who have remained true to the ancient religion are still under their sway. One of the strong centers was in Guatemala, and of their order was the author of the book called Popol Vuh." Although Dr. Scherzer published his copy under the title Las Historias del Origen de los Indios de Guatemala por el R.P.F. Francisco Ximenes, this is misleading. Ximenes was not the author, but acted in the capacity of scribe, translator, and commentator. The work is said to have been compiled originally in the 17th century by a Guatemalan who had been converted to Christianity. Most American Indians are unsatisfactory converts, for they accept new beliefs without discarding old convictions. This is a most fortunate state of affairs, as there is little indication that the indigenous mythology has been compromised. The source of the material compiled by this convert is completely unknown, but it could well have been derived from a secret book or from oral tradition guarded in the sanctuaries of the mysteries. Now, to have secured it, the compiler must himself have been a priest or initiate. Certainly, the Popol Vuh is by far the outstanding available text on pre-Columbian mythology and cosmology existing. The Quichean scribe, in his introduction to the Popol Vuh, writes, "The following is what we shall write, and we place it in writing because since the Word of God has been promulgated, and hereafter during the cycle of Christianity, the book of the azure-green veil is no longer to be seen, in which it could be clearly perceived that it had come from the further shore of the sea, which book has been called the record of our existence in the overshadowing world, and how we there beheld light and life." Now, note that this translation by Price is somewhat fuller than that given by Guthrie and seems to be more in the spirit of the Quiche tradition. And the implication, folks, is that the work originated behind the azure veil. This can have two meanings, either the veil which divides the spiritual universe from the material world, or the veil in the temple of initiation, behind which are the seven lords of the great heart. The Popol Vuh consists of a mythology gradually mingling in its descent with the beginnings of history. The early part deals almost entirely with superhuman beings, and the latter part with the heroic deeds of authentic personages. It opens with a description of the creation. All was calm and silent, and the face of the earth was not yet to be seen. In the eternal darkness and quietude was the Creator, the Lord and Maker, and Gucumatz, the plumed serpent. They were surrounded with green and azure, and they were those who engendered. Then the Word came and spake with them, and they joined their counsels. Those who engender then said, Let it be done. Let the waters retire and cease to obstruct, to the end that it be sown, and that the light of day shine in the heavens and upon the earth. For we shall receive neither glory nor honor from all that we have created and formed, until human beings exist endowed with sentience. Thus the Creator said, Earth, and immediately it was formed. The book proceeds much in the spirit of the scriptures of other nations. It is divided generally into four parts: cosmogony, theogony, anthropology, and regeneration through initiation. It is presented in semi-historical form and includes the initiation of its heroes into the mysteries of Xibalba. The heroes of the Popol Vuh were subjected to several ordeals of tests of courage, fortitude, and skill. The seventh test took place in the House of the Bat. This was a subterranean labyrinth inhabited by weird monsters and ruled over by Gamazots, a fearful creature with the body of a man and the wings and the head of a bat. Naturally, the account is clothed in the culture symbolism of the Mayas, but it is certainly to be compared with such productions as the Finnish Kalevala and the Icelandic Eddas. Guthrie presents a number of important parallelisms to the mysteries of the Egyptians, Chaldeans, and Greeks. According to him, the 12 trials or tests through which the neophytes pass are analogous with the signs of the zodiac. He goes so far as to hazard the speculation that the 12 princes of Xibalba were the rulers of the Atlantean Empire, and their final destruction referred to the tragic end of Atlantis. Well, folks, it's time to take our break. Don't go away. I'll be right back after this very short pause.
Thank you.
Hello, folks. This is William Cooper speaking to you now for Swiss America Trading. Our sponsor, also our friend, our backer, our mentor, and many other things. Good people, just like you and I, really care about this country, care about the truth. They know that God must exist for our Constitution and nation to survive. They understand the purpose of this program, and they back the hour of the time fully. Now, folks, they're also a business that provides investments for people who want to protect their assets during hard times, economic collapse, times of inflation, depression. You think of it, and they can provide it to help you as far as hard assets are concerned. Some we recommend, some we don't. They have non-confiscatable, non-reportable hard assets. They have bullion. They have precious metals of many different kinds. All of these have been proven throughout history to be the very best, and in most cases, the only means of protecting your assets, the things that you've worked for all of your life. So call now 1-800-289-2646 and talk to them. Ask them what they have available, what they recommend, and ask them about their other programs. Do it now, 1-800-289-2646. And for the first 200 callers, folks, you will get Harry Figge's report entitled Tackle the Debt. Also, mention my name, William Cooper, for a free newsletter on protecting your future. And by protecting your future, folks, you're protecting the future of the hour of the time, and of course, freedom for the world. So call now 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. You'll be glad that you did.
Thank you.
The papal vow follows the traditional form by involving its principal characters in a series of superhuman and supernatural adventurers. The work is certainly an account of the perilous journey, which is the usual means employed to veil thinly the story of initiation. By comparison with the oral traditions of the northern Amerindian tribes, the legend unfolds what Dr. Paul Radden beautifully calls the road of light. Medicine priests have freely acknowledged that in dreams and trances they could leave their bodies and travel to the abodes of the gods and the dead. To make this journey while still living is initiation, for it is conscious participation in the fact of immortality. In some cults, the neophyte was given sacred drugs to intensify his psychic faculties, as in the case of the notorious peyote sect, or was subjected to hypnotic influence, like the followers of the ghost shirt religion. By some means, a condition of death was simulated, and the consciousness or superior self passed through certain internal experiences of which at least a partial memory was preserved. The entire process of creation took place within the green and azure coils of the plumed serpent. On several continents, the serpent was among the important symbols of the initiate priest. Sometimes the serpent stands erect and is crowned, as in Egypt, or it may be winged, as among the Mongolians, or feathered and plumed, as throughout the Americas. Obviously, the natives did not intend to imply that they believed in the actual existence of winged snakes, for no such creatures ever existed among them. The serpent was a wisdom symbol, and when plumed, it meant that wisdom had been given wings and had become spirit, wisdom, or illumination. Price suggests that Matthew chapter 10, verse 16 explains the symbolism of the snake bird. Quote, "Behold, I send you as sheep into the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and guileless as doves." Unquote. Now let me read the same passage from Matthew chapter 10, verse 16 again, with the mystery religion meaning. Quote, "Behold, I send you as neophytes into the midst of the profane. Be ye therefore wise as magicians and guileless as mystics." Unquote. Mr. Price was a Greek scholar, and his translation differed slightly from the King James Version, as you can see. He felt that the quetzal had the same meaning as dove, and that the creature combining the serpent wisdom and the bird intuition or inspiration represented the adept, in whom the mind and heart doctrine were completely reconciled. The conflict between the initiate and the adversary, or the paths of white and black magic, is always present. In the story of Daganoweda, the power of evil was personified by Atotarho, an old war chieftain who had a cluster of venomous serpents on his head in place of hair. The Mexican Quetzalcoatl was attacked by the red god of war. The adversary personified either older cults which opposed the establishment of the benevolent mysteries or later cults responsible for the destruction of these institutions. In either case, an inferior state of spiritual enlightenment was implied. The mysteries were institutions of liberation and were naturally opposed by groups seeking to keep their people in bondage through ignorance. The struggle was therefore between religion as temporal authority and the mystery faith, the internal, quote, road of light, unquote. The ruins of the past explain why it was the common belief that the men of good spirit, the initiates, were sacrificed to the material ambitions of temporal rulers. Now, folks, you can apply this same logic to the mystery religion of today. Where they refer to the adversary, they are talking about the same religious institutions, governments, and groups of people that Mr. Hall refers to in discussing the ancient mystery religions of the Aztecs and the Mayans. Only in their modern writings, they will never disclose that. All the Aboriginal tribes of North America practiced mystical and magical rites and vestiges of an esoteric tradition served by a priestly class distinguished for sagacity and personal integrity are still to be found among surviving groups. Scattered over a vast area and divided further by lack of a common language, these nomadic bands were approaching the horizon of national existence when the European colonists conquered their lands, decimated their tribes, and destroyed their cultural patterns. So diversified were the traditions of these peoples that it is difficult to summarize their beliefs and doctrines, especially after their legends, histories, and religious institutions were corrupted by outside influences. The European colonists were of no mind to search for the mystical secrets of the Indian life way. These settlers brought their own religious beliefs, which they were resolved to force upon the natives. There were no ethnologists or anthropologists among the Puritans, and many important landmarks of Indian philosophy were destroyed before they had been honestly investigated or appraised. Most of the tribal lore was in the keeping of priests and elders, and if these were killed or died without finding suitable successors, the traditions ended. Even today, older Indians find it difficult to select younger men to perpetuate the sacred institutions. Thus, it is unwise to assume that from available fragments a complete picture of Indian mysticism can ever be reconstructed. The Indian has always been an individualist, and neither circumstance nor inclination induced him to form extensive intertribal organizations. His way of life and the vast silences of his homeland caused him to turn within himself for courage, wisdom, and faith. He could not visit distant shrines of learning or sit at the feet of famous teachers. There were no books to ponder and no ancient sages to guide his religious convictions. Few strangers visited his camp with news or opinions from far places. He was part of a small family, and the tribal life with its simple lore was his only source of cultural tradition. A thoughtful observer of nature about him, the Indian lived constantly in the presence of mysteries with no reference frame other than his own imagination. Though stoical in appearance, he was highly emotional, as indicated by his songs, dances, and festivals. His sensory perceptions were acute, and his legends indicate strong dramatic instincts. Among advanced tribes, according to Dr. Franz Boas, an elaborate series of esoteric doctrines and practices exists which are known to only a small portion of the tribe, while the mass of the people are familiar only with part of the ritual and with its exoteric features. For this reason, we often find the religious beliefs and practices of the mass of a tribe rather heterogeneous as compared with the beliefs held by the priests. Among many of the tribes in which priests are found, we find distinct esoteric societies, and it is not by any means rare that the doctrines of one society are not in accord with those of another. Esoteric forms of religion in charge of priests are found among the tribes of the arid region of the Southwest, the tribes of the southern Mississippi basin, and, to a less extent, among the more northerly tribes of the plains. It would seem that, on the whole, the importance of the esoteric teachings decreases among the more northerly and northeasterly tribes of the continent. Medicine priests were trained by their predecessors or were called to their life work by some miraculous incident. The little Indian boy, who early in life showed a tendency to dreams and visions, was encouraged to select this career. In a highly organized tribal system, he was initiated into the religious institutions of his nation, receiving the lore of the old priests and fragments of tribal history. If he belonged to some small, wandering band, his entire spiritual education had come from within and was induced by fasting and vigil. The vigil was the most widely practiced religious discipline of the Amerinds. In all matters of emergency or great decision, the Indian sought solitude. He went alone to some high place, built a small campfire, planted around him a circle of prayer plumes, smoked the ceremonial pipe, and waited through the long hours of the night for the voices. The voices instructed him in the herbs of healing, taught him the songs and dances, and brought him news of what was transpiring in distant places. There are many stories about medicine priests learning to leave their bodies at will and journeying into the Shadowland to guide the dying to the home of ghosts. Many of these grand old mystics were wise in the ways of the spirit and should be regarded as duly initiated members of esoteric orders. The miraculous powers of the medicine priests extended over a wide variety of phenomena. They healed the sick, protected their tribes. They directed the migrations of their peoples and sought by extrasensory means the location of food, water, and other necessities. They predicted the future. They induced rain and storms, projected themselves to distant places, and read the hearts and minds of their fellow men. It was in their power to induce visions and trances and to receive the impressions of the star spirits. They also gained considerable proficiency in the mesmeric and hypnotic arts. One Charles F. Loomis, who spent many years among the Southwest Indians of the United States, described the miracles performed by the medicine priests. Although naturally skeptical, his experiences among the Navajo and Pueblo Indians impressed him deeply. Mr. Loomis mentioned how Indians seated in their medicine lodge created miniature thunderstorms within the room, accompanied by flashes of forked lightning, while the outside sky was entirely clear. He says, quote, "How the effects are produced, I am utterly unable to explain, but they are startlingly real," unquote. He was also impressed by the ability of the priests to change themselves into animals in the presence of spectators. Some priests could create an artificial sun inside the lodge. This miniature luminary rose in the eastern side of the room, crossed overhead, and set in the west during the performance of the sacred chants. Now, Amerindian priests grow the sacred corn in exactly the same way that the East Indian mendicant grows his mango tree. The magician plants the seed, which grows immediately, and about 3 hours later the stalk is laden with fully developed ears of corn. Other writers have reported that in some of the medicine lodges the Indians are able to levitate large stones and to cause their own bodies to float in the air. Unprejudiced observers have been forced to conclude that among most tribes of Amerinds, magical rituals are performed involving the use of natural forces beyond the normal experience of human beings. The Amerindic concept of cosmogony paralleled in a general way that of the Chaldeans and other peoples who dwelt in the valley of the Euphrates. The world consisted of three regions, with human beings inhabiting the surface of the central zone. Above this middle land was an airy expanse extending to the abode of the Sky Father. Below the surface were subterranean levels extending downward to the place of the Earth Mother, and this cavernous region was like the dark and shadowy underworld of the pre-Homeric Greeks. In the Southwest legends, human beings originated beneath the earth in a kind of paradisical land. There also were mountains, valleys, and of course beautiful plains, and a sun and moon that lighted the region. In the beginning, everyone was happy. But later, an evil deed brought upon them the wrath of the gods. In most accounts, this lovely shadow land was destroyed by a flood. In some miraculous manner, a few righteous persons were preserved and took refuge on a tall plant, which, growing rapidly, finally broke through the surface of the middle land, bringing the survivors to safety. The secrets of healing, prophecy, and magic came to the Indian from an order of beings called Manitos. This Algonquin word is now applied to the concept of powerful governing spirits. The Manitos were not actually gods, but superhuman man-like creatures possessing extraordinary attributes and frequently considered as giants. The size factor, however, is figurative rather than literal. The Manitos were a divine, invisible tribe, masters of magic, to whom human beings could turn for help and guidance whenever necessity arose. The effort to explain the term Manitou as only signifying a, quote, wonderful power, unquote, and synonymous with the Iroquois Orinda is not sufficient to meet the requirements of the Indian religious philosophy. Orinda conveys more precisely a power or energy universally present in animate and inanimate creatures and manifesting through the vital processes which cause things to exist, to function, and to affect other existing and functioning things. It might be safer, folks, to assume that the Manitous represented the intelligence controlling and directing the, quote, wonderful power, unquote. The Indian, therefore, was confronted with the same basic questions which disturbs even the most advanced physicist, namely, is there a supreme intelligence governing universal procedure? The religious concepts of the Indians, writes Dr. Boas, may be described in two groups, those that concern the individual and those that concern the social group, such as tribe and clan. The fundamental concept bearing on the religious life of the individual is the belief in the existence of magic power, which may influence the life of man and which in turn may be influenced by human activity. In this sense, magic power must be understood as the wonderful qualities which are believed to exist in objects, animals, men, spirits, or deities, and which are superior to the natural qualities of man. Most religions and metaphysical philosophies include hierarchies of divine creatures or tutelary spirits as mediators between the supreme being and mortals. The Manitous acted as wise distributors of the Orinda. The Indian fashioned these demigods in his own likeness, but bestowed upon them superior powers. The Manitous were aware of the most secret human thoughts and the most pressing human needs, and were capable of responding immediately to the rituals of the priests and elders. When the medicine man journeyed to the spirit land, he might be invited to attend a council of Manitous. When he came to the great lodge in the sky, it resembled an earthly council place, except that it was larger, of course more elegant, and usually filled with a strange light. The Manitous were venerable sachems, usually handsome old men, their faces full of kindness. There was a council fire, smoking of the calumet, and the usual speeches and discussions. The lodge was a kind of superphysical senate where all matters of grave import were decided. When the session was concluded, the priest returned to his people along the sky road and reported the decisions of the great lodge. Between the Manitous and mankind were the souls of the illustrious dead. These were the olds and the trues, the sages of long ago, the great chieftains, warriors, and statesmen. They had led their people in life, so they continued to guard them from the other land, speaking through the medicine men. It seemed natural to the Amerinds that the heroes who had gone before should continue to serve the tribes they had guided in the long ago. Totemism was a kind of heraldry among the Indians. The totem was the clan symbol, but even more than that, it was a channel for the distribution of Orinda through the social and political structure of the clan. The totemic animal or bird was a spirit guardian, helpful because the creature possessed attributes superior in some particular to those of man. The attribute might be swiftness, strength, cunningness, or resourcefulness, and these qualities the totem creature shared with those under its guardianship. Each Indian also had his own totem, and while it took a familiar form, it was identical in principle with the guardian daemon described in works on the Egyptian and Chaldean mysteries. It was considered a good omen to see one's totem while practicing vigil or in dreams or trances. It proved the proximity of a protecting power. The Abbe Favonet, a missionary to the Algonquins, identifies the totem from Ote, the Ototemen of the Chippewas, with the Manitou concept in these words. It is to be presumed that in uniting into a tribe, each clan preserves its Manitou, the animal which in the country whence the clan came was the most beautiful or the most friendly to man, or the most feared or the most common, the animal which was ordinarily hunted there and which was the ordinary subsistence of the clan, etc. And this animal became the symbol of each family, and that each family transmitted it to its posterity to be the perpetual symbol of each tribe or clan. Modern ethnologists have emphasized that the popular usage of the term totem is incorrect. The symbol is not strictly religious, but involves a social and family concept with emphasis upon the importance of kinship. Folks, if you'd like to send for an information packet, send a self-addressed stamped envelope with 58 cents postage to the address that you'll hear at the end of this program. All the tape orders are out, folks. This duplicating machine works fantastic. Good night, and God bless you all.
One more kiss, dear. One more sigh. Only this, dear, is goodbye. For our love is such pain and such pleasure. From the trees tumble to the ground and die. So in the springtime, like sweet memories, they will return as will I. Like the sun, dear, upon high, will return.
Sorrow.